Cinema surely taught us one thing. If we haven't really seen the body, character cannot be considered irreversibly dead, even if he or she happens to fall into a waterfall or volcano. It is often very inconvenient to kill movie characters, both for emotional purposes, I mean, everyone loves the good old happy ending for characters that deserve it, and also for franchise development, since as long as the character is alive, there are always more sequels and cash to be made. Resurrection of a seemingly dead character is a powerful cathartic plot point, and so no big wonder that it got overused over the years. Besides being resistant to trauma and capable of resurrection, movie characters also tend to recover from injuries inhumanly fast, as fast as the plot needs them back in action, sometimes in a matter of days or even hours. The audience has been taught all that by media over the decades, and now general public finds it difficult to believe that these movie guys can get seriously hurt at all, least of all die, at least for as long as there are real people who want to buy merch with these imaginary guys. That raises an interesting question in terms of science fiction hardness. How much injuries exactly can lead realistic character to death? I mean, if we switch off the plot drivers and franchise needs, how much trauma could they really survive? To answer that question, we'll use science fiction hardness scale that I explained in one of my previous videos. In short, the higher the tier, the harder the science. Top diamond tier, of course, goes to us, real living human beings, who sometimes have asthma or diabetes, sometimes develop sepsis from a small finger cut, and sometimes die falling down from our own height, which is, by the way, something that even giraffes can't do. Humans are of course all different, and some might take much more damage than others before they ultimately collapse. Trauma outcome might depend on physical training, health conditions, amount and quality of medical help, exact type of injury, and many other factors. It is true, of course, that we humans have a history of miraculous survival cases in seemingly lethal circumstances, such as a fall from a plane or a shark attack. But at the same time, thousands of people still die each year from choking or insect bites. So, while humans get lucky from time to time, in general, we are quite vulnerable, even compared to the animals of similar size. Slightly lower than that, we have tungsten tier, which breaks one or two of the human anatomy and/or physiology rules. Most common offenders on the list are low sensitivity to pain, quick regeneration, and a limbs not lethal rule. While being insensitive to pain has its obvious benefits, it has its downsides too. Pain usually exists for a reason. It's a red alert that organism sirens from the inside, a signal that things are bad. If ignored, source of pain will soon lead to new, even worse structural damage, which is very counterproductive to the survival of character. Out of all animals, only the most primitive, like sponges, feel no pain at all. So, the next time you see a movie character with gunshot wounds who runs around and shoots back at the enemies, try to remember the last time you hit your little foot finger at the bed edge by accident, and then try to imagine how this gunshot gunslinger should probably actually feel. As for regeneration, it takes at least a week before it's safe to remove the stitches from the wound. Most of the deep stabbed and shot wounds of the torso and head require surgical revision to heal at all, and the fastest that broken bone can grow back together is approximately a month. Anyone healing faster than that is a little bit superhuman and thus ends up in tungsten tier. Limbs not lethal rule is when character doesn't get considered to be in a lethal threat if it's only his limb that is injured, even in cases of full amputation. That is far from true, not even speaking of small wound infections. There are several major arteries, such as axillary, brachial, ulnar, radial, femoral, popliteal, tibial, and peroneal, and any of them can produce bleeding to death in a matter of minutes if injured and not treated properly. Sure, there are reptiles and amphibians who can easily survive losing a limb, but that sadly in no way applies to humans, and while torso or head injury is certainly riskier, arm or leg trauma can easily cause lethal outcome as well. While one or two of the mentioned issues might still keep the injured character in the tungsten sci-fi hardness tier, all three of them will put it down into the iron and glass tier, which has a rule of its own: head, neck, heart. Head, neck, heart rule states that the character can only be killed by either a headshot, a heart shot, or the separation of head from the body. These characters follow limbs not lethal rule, of course, and usually are both insensitive to pain and abnormally effective in regeneration. We commonly see head, neck, heart rule in movie zombies, aliens, or mutants, but a lot of supposedly human characters also have that. This model is of course true in many ways. Head, neck and heart trauma are not only the humanly possible causes of death, but also the most lethal of possible injuries. However, fracture of the pelvis can be as dangerous for life as fracture of the skull, and a gunshot to a aorta at any point of her length is as lethal as a heart shot. The final red line that separates at least somewhat realistic human characters from impossible life forms is head and body separation. It is somehow painfully obvious, even to the least educated of the audience, that in such a state life cannot go on. But Robert E. rule for injuries is head shots only, which means heart shots are no longer lethal, as well as body and or head can still stay functional even after separated. Robert E. trauma resistance is common in zombies, which actually were my whole reason to make this video. The thing is, I've made this other video about zombies in hard science fiction, where I analyze their possible origins, behavior, diet and, among other stuff, sensitivity to injuries. But I spoke about it mostly in terms of ability to feel pain, and didn't delve into another important aspect, structural integrity of the organism. So I tried to figure out how would that look, and after I made the first sketch of the tier list, I realized that it is bigger than zombies. I mean, since zombies have basically the same anatomy as us humans, I was actually making physical resistance tier list for a human type character, possibly even humanoid type. As for zombies, well, it seems like the most common type of their resistance to death, headshot only, is in the rubber tier of scientific hardness. Besides headshot only rule, rubber tier damage resistance also commonly brings in fast regeneration and minimal to non-pain sensitivity, as well as resistance to radiation, electricity, high and low temperatures, chemical corrosives, falls from height, traffic accidents and asphyxia, which are all indisputably uncharacteristic for Homo sapiens. Speaking of the headshot itself, it's worth noting that while it is undoubtedly an effective way to kill a human, it is actually not as lethal as a heart shot. There's a popular belief that we only use brain for 10% of its capacity or so, which is not exactly true. But it's true that our brain has an impressive ability to rewire itself, assigning functions of the damaged brain parts to intact ones. In fact, people were known to live even after removal of half of their brain. So if a bullet goes through all of your head, you still have a little chance to survive and even regain a lot of lost function. If a bullet goes through all of your heart, however, you have a minute of life at best. Because of that, I'd rate heart-shot-only humanoid characters as high rubber tier and headshot-only as low rubber tier, and move on to the last degree of damage resistance, the one where neither headshots nor heart shots work anymore, the physical immortality. If a character can resist and or regenerate from injury that would destroy regular human's head and or heart, that character exists in the fairy tale realm of cake-tier science fiction. Such a degree of resistance is sometimes demonstrated by creatures way more primitive than humans, but not in any species that are, say, capable of passing the mirror test. If something restores from dismembered pieces or survives even the most severe injuries, it has nothing to do with human anatomy as we know it. Actually, I'd say even more. If a human-sized creature can either resist or regenerate from injuries like a headshot, heartshot, and decapitation, it is not only not human, but also not a vertebrate, probably not even a cell-based life form, with the most likely explanation being that it is not organic at all. So here you have it. More or less scientifically accurate scale of how hard it is to kill a character in fiction. As I have mentioned, besides humans, it might be applicable to humanoid characters as well, since having similar anatomy would lead to similar weaknesses, but that is surely a topic for another video of its own. As for now, thanks for watching, and if you want to support the channel, like, subscribe and stay hardcore!